The government has been devastated by this. The government also only receives a small portion of the aid money that goes there, less than a cent that it goes there.
Of every dollar.
So there has to be some sort of way, and he desires some sort of way to play a role in the future of Haiti. Now, I think there is there's a place for him. That's not for me to say, of course, or not for those who are here who want to advocate that, but I'm sure the Haitian people would welcome his return.
I actually asked a number of people. I mean, using the model of President Obama standing with George W. Bush and Bill Clinton, a sort of unified front, that this isn't a partisan issue helping Haiti. The idea of a unified front in Haiti, President René Préval, President Jean-Bertrand Aristide in this time of need.
Absolutely. I mean, of course. I mean, we see George Bush and Bill Clinton, former presidents, who've been the key orchestrators of the undermining of Haitian sovereignty and democracy, standing right there, supposedly play some sort of role. But I think it's very key that there's a plan for Haiti. And we have to begin to, as progressives and people who are concerned about Haiti and have been concerned about it, we have to begin to build some sort of consensus, a movement around the Haiti that the Haitians envision. The plan is not what the Haitians envision. Of course, it's never been what the Haitians envision from the outset of its independence. But we must be there to support what their plan is. And certainly their plan is a plan in which there's reconstruction, where Haitians participate in that. We're not past the immediate crisis. There's no doubt about that. People are still without food, without water, without air. You have the rains coming. You have the potential of hurricanes coming. All those things, real soon. We're not past that. But it's important for us to to continue to begin lobby, to pressure Congress, and John Conyers has been very good, and members of the Black Caucus are very good, Maxine Waters is very good, to pressure them to make sure that the Haitians' voice is in the process of this building process. Not only that, but those needs that are met, the immediate needs, medical needs, etc., are dealt with. You know, we do not want the militarization of Haiti. We do not see Haitian as a protectorate, which relinquishes its own sovereignty. The important thing is that Haitians be part of this whole process. And certainly, in my opinion, and I'm saying my opinion, President Aristide, or as you want to say, Father Aristide, however you want to present, it has a central role and a key role to play in that process.
I wanted to go back to President Aristide in 2004, and this may indicate why he is not coming back to Haiti. And it's the U.S. role in what happened. Aristide has not returned to Haiti since he was ousted in February 2004. It was February 29th, and what he calls a modern-day kidnapping in the service of a coup d'etat backed by the United States. He was flown in a U.S. Military jet with U.S. security to the Central African Republic. 2 weeks later, a small delegation led by U.S. Congressmember Maxine Waters and TransAfrica founder Randa Robinson flew to the Central African Republic to try to escort the Aristides back to the Caribbean. I went with them to cover the story and was on the flight back with the Aristides. I had an extended interview with President Aristide on the plane as we flew over Africa and the Atlantic. I asked him about being forced out of office and the U.S. allegations that he simply resigned.
President Aristide, did you resign?
No, I didn't resign. What some people call resignation is a new coup d'etat or a modern kidnapping.
And why do you call it a coup?
Because they broke the constitutional order by using force to have me out of the country the way it happened.
How did it happen?
I will not go to details, maybe next time, but as I said, they use force. When you have militaries coming from abroad, surrounding your house, taking control of the airport, surrounding the National Palace, being in the streets, and take you from your house to put you in a plane where you have to spend 20 hours without knowing where they were going to go with you, without talking about details, which I already did somehow in other occasions. It was using force to take an elected president out of his country.
That was President Aristide. That was on the flight back in a plane in March of 2004. And you can see the whole interview at democracynow.org. Danny Glover, he says he was the victim of a modern-day kidnapping, a coup in service of the—that was backed by the United States.
France and Canada, yes. Yes, I think it's pretty evident. All the information that's come out in the last 5 years, now almost nearly 5 years, suggested it was a coup. It certainly, when we talk about President Aristide, whatever his distractors may say, whatever people may say, he attempted to bring some sort of continuum of democracy to Haiti. It was the first time in Haiti's history that you moved from Aristide to President Provol to back to Aristide. First time there was some sort of continuity in this democracy, in its history. But as always, as we've noted, and perhaps one of the things that have come out of this whole thing is that we'll learn the lesson, and we'll learn more about really what has happened to Haiti. Maybe people will ask the right questions now about this history, the extraordinary history of the Haitian people, and ask those questions in a way in which they understand the complicit role the United States has played since Thomas Jefferson in undermining Haitian sovereignty, how Europe, Germany, France continue to undermine its sovereignty. So I think there's a chance, there's an opportunity for a different kind of discussion about Haiti. But it's key in that discussion and understanding this extraordinary people, extraordinary resiliency, extraordinary will, you know, and resistance to being dominated, that this lies in the heart of the Haitian people, and that will in itself will allow us to kind of imagine the possibility that Haiti can exist in Haiti.
I wanted to go now to an excerpt of a documentary that actually my colleague here at Democracy Now!, co-host Juan Gonzalez, wrote the screenplay, if you will, or rather the script for, because it is not, it is a documentary. To put history of Haiti in context, we're going to go to Haiti, Killing the Dream, that was produced by Hort and Dana Perry.